Good morning and welcome to the eighth meeting in 2016 of the Finance and Constitution Committee. We've received apologies both from our Vice Convener Alec Johnson and also from Neil Bibby. Can I just remind members to switch off their mobile phones or at least put them in a mode that don't interfere with the proceedings? The first item on our agenda this morning is to decide whether to take item 7 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you, we have agreed. The second item on our agenda is to continue to take evidence as part of our inquiry into the first year's operation of the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax. This will be the final session of our current inquiry and we are joined this morning for it by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Constitution, Derek Mackay, who's accompanied by Aidan Griswood, the Head of Fiscal Responsibility Division of the Scottish Government. Members will have received copies of the letter from Mr. Mackay. But before we go into any questions, I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would like to make a short opening statement.
Thank you and good morning, Convener. As I said in my letter of 26th of August, very much welcome your inquiry and the participation of all stakeholders at the earlier committee sessions. It's important to hear all aspects of the evidence around the first year of LBTT. I'd like to cover first our policy priorities in setting residential LBTT rates and bans. We set progressive residential LBTT rates and bans to prioritise support for first-time buyers and those buying houses at the lower end of the market by redistributing the tax burden towards higher value homes. At lower end of the residential market, taxpayers in Scotland do not pay LBTT until the value of the property they purchase is above £145,000, as opposed to £125,000 for UK SDLT. This progressive measure took nearly 9,700 extra house buyers out of tax altogether in 2015-16. A further 41,700 house buyers in Scotland paid less tax on their house purchases between £145,000 and £330,000 than they would have under SDLT. As the submission points out, these benefits have been achieved whilst meeting the residential LBTT forecast, allowing for forestalling effects and exceeding the non-residential forecast. Our analysis has found no evidence of a long-term suppression of housing transactions at the upper end of the Scottish housing market following the introduction of LBTT in April 2015. Turning now to revenues, I informed Parliament in the provisional outturn statement in June that the devolved taxes generated £572 million in revenue in 2015-16 against our original forecast of £498 million, allowing me to take the responsible step of placing £74 million in a Scottish cash reserve. The overall surplus indicated a surplus of £44 million from LBTT with a shortfall of £27 million on residential properties, offset by a £71 million surplus on non-residential properties. However, it is important to note that the shortfall in the residential properties includes transitional forestalling effects. When the Deputy First Minister wrote to the previous Finance Committee with a detailed analysis of proposed residential LBTT rates in January of 2015, he noted that the residential LBTT forecast for 2015-16 of £235 million did not take account of forestalling effects. A £27 million shortfall against the original forecast therefore includes the one-off loss of revenue arising from the transition from SDLT to LBTT, which saw the purchase of a significant number of high-value properties brought forward into the 2014-15 financial year. As I state in my letter to the committee, the Scottish Government remains committed to undertaking a review of the operation of LBTT rates and bans now that we have a full year of outturn data. This inquiry is providing very useful evidence which I'll consider as part of that review. In addition, I've convened two roundtable events to take place on the 10th of November where I will discuss and challenge the evidence of any impact on LBTT on residential and non-residential property markets with a range of stakeholders as well as gather evidence and other factors that may be impacting the performance on the markets. Not least of those factors is likely to be local oil-related economic difficulties in Aberdeen City and Shire. Registers of Scotland data yesterday pointed to residential transactions falling sharply over the year, yet they were rising modestly in the rest of Scotland, where local housing markets are not as exposed to those northeast difficulties. Finally, Convener, I will announce my intentions with regards to residential and non-residential LBTT rates and bans as part of the forthcoming Scottish Budget and look forward to answering the committee's questions.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. In your opening statement, you also mentioned yourself issues around forestalling. And I'm aware that our predecessor committee recommended to the government should undertake analysis of the initial behavioural responses to LBTT once they had available to them a full year of outturn data, particularly in whether or not there were any long-term behavioural aspects regarding the new tax at the higher end of the market. Now, you mentioned, I think, that you had to undertake some analysis, that it was considered that these might be temporary phenomena, if I've got that right, in terms of the way you described that at the beginning. Would you like to just extrapolate a bit more on that issue? Because it's something the committee have taken a considerable amount of interest on, and whether or not it was temporary behavioural changes or longer term changes we were dealing with.
So I think I've covered some of the forecasting issues and the range of forecasts. With any forecast, you won't get it exactly right. A damn good forecaster that can, but there's obviously a range of forecasts. But there was inevitably going to be some cultural behaviour, people bringing forward sales to avoid a higher level of tax. And I think there was evidence of that certainly happening, and that's impacted over the year. So we can't say what the long-term trajectory will be, because we're just beyond the 1 year, of course, and a further couple of quarters data. But from the statistics that I've seen around the share and the composition of value of properties, the patterns, there seems to be more of a consistency. And one of the issues that's been raised, particularly by Murdo Fraser in the past, was around those properties at the higher end. And I've taken a very specific look at that to be reassured that the higher value properties, that there isn't a distortion of the market and people aren't forever putting off sales and transactions. So it does appear on the data that we have that the broad compositions, the same in terms of share transactions. Now, there are separate issues around revenue and impacts in the housing market, maybe around house prices and value, but in terms of share of transactions, that cultural behaviour that we saw in the early days does seem to have levelled off, but that's only on the data that we have so far. So as to your longer term question, we will only know that when we have more data.
Okay. And could I turn to Marie, please?
Hi there. I've been asking a number of people about the additional dwelling supplement. I know that it was introduced very quickly in response to a policy change from the UK government. I just wonder if you have any reflections on how that went.
I suppose the principle around it was to make sure that Scotland wasn't subject to simply more people investing for simply buy to let. We didn't want to distort the housing market in Scotland, particularly at the lower end as well. That's why we took the same action to follow on from what the UK government has done. And I suppose that degree of harmony has panned out to be the right decision.
Yeah, and I think because it was introduced so rapidly, there are probably refinements that need to be made going forward. And I hear you saying that one of the policy objectives was to target the buy-to-let market. I represent an area, as you know, in the Highlands and Islands, where there are a high number of second home ownership. You know, it's a high level of second home ownership. And whilst that's important for the tourist economy, it is a challenge for some communities to absorb when more than half of the housing stock is owned by people who don't live there. I just wonder what your thoughts are in terms of refining that tax going forward. I know you won't be able to announce it today, but have you got thoughts about what you will consider in terms of refinements going forward?
I don't have any immediate proposals to announce today at committee, but I'm certainly in listening mode on this if you think there are suggestions for improvement. And when any legislation or regulations are produced, there are sometimes unintended consequences, and there may be individual constituency cases that have been raised with me that would lead me to look again to make sure that if there's any refinements that are required, then we will do that in a very methodical way. So absolutely there's a focus on, in terms of the policy, the broad approach, I think it's been the right thing to do, considering how we followed on from UK government. and reflected on their proposition around this. And then separately to LBTT, of course, there's the policies on council tax that parliamentary committees have considered around second homes discounts, for example. So there are other levers that can be used to address the issues that the member quite rightly raises. But in terms of the specifics of LBTT and ADS, then I want to look again, make sure it's refined and there are no unintended consequences arising from the legislation or how we've deployed that tax policy.
Thank you.
Patrick.
Good morning. A lot of the discussion around the impact of LBTT on the housing market has been around the issue you mentioned around forestalling and the impact on sales at the upper end of the market. I'm interested in the impact on the housing market in general. I tested one of our earlier witnesses on the claim that LBTT has undoubtedly been of benefit to first-time buyers, for example. And I, regardless of the few hundred pounds that a first-time buyer might save, the impact on them is more likely in the long term to be as a result of any changes in house prices. Has the government done any work, or do you believe that there's any evidence to show what effect this change is going to have on property values and on housing costs for the majority, rather than for the tiny number of people who live in the very high-value properties?
I think Mr. Harvey's correct to point out some of the benefits for first-time buyers and
questioning them rather than pointing them out.
I took the inference as quite a positive one. I do forgive me, but I'll make that point anyway. I think the policy has been good for first-time buyers and those at that end of the market. In terms of how the policy has shaped or influenced house values, it's very hard to determine that. Any economist would look at it and say, you can't take the issue in isolation because there's so many other factors now that impact on house values and house prices, from income, general economic performance, geographic issues, and so on. So it's very difficult for me to be able to say what impact the tax regime has had on house prices and house values. I'm sure a good conveyancing solicitor or surveyor or valuer would say, however, that when you're close to the margins of a tax layer, maybe that does influence a final price. Potentially, they might argue that point, but I don't personally think that it has shaped house values. I think there's many factors that play in that.
You're actually suggesting that the tax regime is not going to have an effect on property values.
I'm saying it's one of many considerations as part of values, one of many considerations. And one of the reasons you could draw that conclusion, if you look at the state of the housing market right across Scotland, something totally different is happening in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire to the rest of the country. And that's why I make that point. There's so many different factors at play. I'm sure it's one factor, but not the only factor. I think that was the point I was trying to fairly make.
Okay, you're sure it's one factor. Can I ask what analysis was done on how that factor would impact on property values when you were setting the rates?
Well, it wouldn't have been me at the time, but I would imagine there'd been various assessments. I'd ask maybe Aidan Griswood to cover that point.
Yeah, So the minister's correct in terms of just a multiple range of factors impacting on the housing market and house prices. And this is something we're developing our methodology and forecasts as we go forward. So actually the information that comes forward in terms of the impact of the regime, but also just wider effects as talked about, and just refining our capability to model house prices, not just because there's wider policy reasons, but also in terms of forecasting future revenues. And that will obviously be an important factor of the Scottish Fiscal Commission's work. So in terms of the specifics around the extent to which it impacted on house values, I'm not aware of any effect that was counted into that, and part of that will be because we didn't actually have the previous analysis in terms of those sorts of changes to model, but it would be certainly something that if there wasn't it would be the sort of thing that would be looked at closely alongside all various other factors to make sure that any future forecasts of any changes and the like could be fully considered if there was indeed a relevant and significant, if you like, coefficient that was derived in terms of the impact on house prices.
Will be looked at by the government?
Well,
as a result.
So going forward, the Scottish Fiscal Commission publishes forecasts of future revenues from this, and therefore produce, as part of that, will develop models that are capable of doing that. But we also develop our own modelling in terms of just being able to understand the policy impacts of different decisions, and therefore we need to retain that capability within Scottish Government too.
It was my understanding, Convener, that we'd heard from the Commission that they were likely to conduct that kind of work on revenues, but not on the impact on the housing market. So I'm just wondering whether the government itself will be undertaking that kind of analysis to test whether my gut feeling that, you know, people's benefit or deficit as a result of this change is very likely to be far greater than the few hundred pounds that they're saving through the tax change itself. We need to understand this if we want to know whether this has ultimately been of global benefit to people who are either buying and selling or perhaps not able to get onto the housing market at all.
I think it's a helpful point. I suppose I was trying to answer the point with what we know already, which is why I answered around a range of factors. I'm happy to engage further with the committee and the stakeholders at the roundtable event and hear from those working in the sector to get their intelligence of what further impacts it may be having on values, and, you know, happy to look at that.
Okay, thank you.
Adam?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wanted to ask a couple of questions about the institutional structure of devolved taxation so far. We all know that LBTT was one of the taxes in the vanguard of fiscal devolution, and that much more fiscal devolution is coming during the early part of the lifetime of this Parliament. Are you satisfied, Cabinet Secretary, that we've got the institutional structure right in terms, for example, of the relationship between your office and Revenue Scotland, and in terms also of the relationship between Revenue Scotland and HMRC? Or are there lessons that need to be learned, corrections that need to be made as we engage in further fiscal devolution in the coming months and years?
I think that's a very helpful question. No, I think that LBTT is actually a good working example of where the infrastructure in place has been effective and efficient. And I would refer back to the Adam Smith principles of taxation, which we've deployed in their efficiency, convenience, proportionality, and certainty and reliability, and all those maxims we've been able to deliver and in practice. And I'm sure you've heard, in fact, I've seen the evidence that you've heard from Revenue Scotland. They are a slick, efficient operation, and some of it because it's around digital first, a good approach, and good working arrangements with HMRC as well. So this is actually a good example of a devolved power taxation being delivered in an efficient and effective way. If I go into other areas where there's transition of power, you know, there is much more work to be done on other areas, but I think this has been a success story.
Thank you. Second question, I don't know if you had a chance to look at the evidence we received near the beginning of our inquiry from the Law Society, but I was very struck by what the Law Society said about how the structure of LBTT was similar to the structure of so many taxes at a UK level, which is that we tax by statute and untax by extra statutory concession. So the idea is that tax legislation is as complete as it possibly can be, but there are always gaps. And those gaps are filled not by formal amendment to the law, but by discretion exercised by the tax authority, in this instance, Revenue Scotland. And they expressed, I think it would be right to say that it was concern, certainly not alarm, but concern here was an opportunity, in a sense, perhaps, with regard to the devolution of tax that had been missed. This is a problem at UK level, that we tax by statute and untaxed by concession, and it's a problem which seems to have been imported into the devolved framework. Is that an issue that has come across your desk, or do you have any reflections upon it?
No, I think that's a helpful reflection. It actually relates back to Marie Todd's question around the original purpose, the delivery, and then further refinement. So it's entirely that point that sometimes we have to work back on some of the specific cases that we may have seen. So I think generally the point's well made. I did see the Law Society's evidence. I thought it was quite measured, and in the true spirit of any solicitor, giving us a range of opinion and challenging both statutory and delivery contributions, but no, I think it's a helpful and a fair point. But I say again, I think how this tax has been deployed has been effective and efficient. And in fairness, both UK government and Scottish government have reflected on each other's decisions to get what's optimal for the UK, for the UK government's point of view, and in Scotland, the Scottish government, where we've been able to respond to what the other is doing. And I would argue, would I not, that inheriting a stamp duty and moving it on to LBTT, we've been able to deliver principles that were very much in keeping with the government's agenda.
Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wonder if I can just go back to the point that the Convener raised in his question to you earlier around this issue of the potential for behavioural change caused by tax rates, particularly on larger properties. And you know, I'm gratified you've been following my lines of questioning to the evidence, to those giving evidence with detail. And I think it's fair to say, to put this in context, we're not talking about multi-million pound houses. We're talking about houses probably in the bracket, you know, £400,000 up to maybe, you know, £700,000 or £800,000, where we have had a lot of evidence as a committee from those working in the sector that they feel there has been a suppression of transactions. You've been very clear in your letter to the committee, and indeed you said just a few moments ago that the Scottish Government had found no evidence of suppression of transactions. When we took evidence on the 5th of October from the Scottish Fiscal Commission on this issue, Professor Campbell Leith told us, and I'll just quote directly from the official report, and he's referring to the Scottish Government's own data collection. He said this: the Scottish Government found that over a two-year period, there was a substantial growth in many of the price bands, except for the £325,000 to £750,000 band, in which there was growth of only 1%. So as far as the Fiscal Commission are concerned, they're not as bullish as you are, or you appear to be, in relation to this issue. So why do you think the Fiscal Commission have got this wrong?
No, I'm nothing if not diligent. I've checked what the Fiscal Commission has actually said. What they said, and this goes back to another statement around revenues being subdued at that end of the market. They didn't say transactions, because I've looked at the number of transactions. I mean, Mr. Fraser would be right if the number of transactions at the upper end had nosedived, and then that argument would have been valid that Murdo Fraser has made, and that's why I looked into it so closely. What I've found is that the number of transactions has largely been sustained as a share of total transactions in Scotland, but values, revenue, has been more subdued. And I would relate that back to generally house prices and house values in Scotland. And then within that, there's a geographic issue in the North East, Aberdeen, City and Shire. And we know what's happening in the economy there. And I think that's what's impacted on some of the values and then therefore some of the outturn figures. But I think it's important to make this point very clearly. I'm not bullish, I'm just leaning on the facts that I have that I would like to share with you. So broadly speaking, using the range that Mr. Fraser's touched upon, you anything from £325,000 up to £750,000 in terms of market activity. From 2014, so before LBTT, share of total transactions across four quarters was 6% of transactions, 7% of transactions, 8% of transactions, and 8% of transactions. So that's over each quarter. Then go to 2015, and it's 10%, 7%, 8%, and 8% on introduction of LBTT, which suggests, you know, not a dip in number of transactions, I say again, but values may be in a different place. And if we go into 2016, it's not quite as high, but it's 7% and 7%. In the quarter two figures, it's totally aligned, 7% over that quarter for 3 years. So That's for those figures. I could do the same exercise on levels above £750,000, and it's the same kind of pattern. I think Mr. Fraser's right to put a focus on this because of how we've deployed the tax policy. We made it clear that we were focusing on that tax relief at the lower end of the market to stimulate the economy, to stimulate purchases, to support first-time buyers. We're doing that, but I'm also very mindful of the impact at the top end and keeping a very close eye on that, and that's why I say that the SFC is not wrong, but the language that I've used was around revenue, not necessarily transactions.
Your former First Minister and your former boss, Alex Salmond, was a great advocate of the Laffer curve theory of economics. Do you share his enthusiasm for Arthur Laffer's economic theory?
I have to say, my very comprehensive briefing, I don't have the detail on such an economic modelling. I've spent enough time with economists since my appointment. I thought I knew it all. But, Mr. Fraser, I think you're going to have to educate me. Maybe you could give me a synopsis now.
I will, very briefly, if I may, Convener. But essentially, the Laffer curve, I thought it was well understood, even by those with a limited grasp of economic theory. But essentially, the Laffer curve theory says that if you raise taxes above a certain level, because that then suppresses activity, your tax take therefore falls. Therefore, there's an optimum level of taxation at which you maximise tax revenue, and tax rates either below that level or above that level actually generate a lower income. I was just interested whether, as a matter of principle, you accepted that principle, that if you set tax rates too high, because that suppresses activity, therefore you receive less revenue as a result.
Yes, of course I accept the principle. Of course.
So you agree with Arthur Laffer?
Well, now you've given me the understanding of it. I'm not going to sign up to it, but I accept the principle. If you tax too much, you might inhibit activity, of course. But we've not done that. Of course, we've delivered an optimal tax system that supported the economy, raised revenue above the figure that we had anticipated, and we've deployed sound financial management to put it in a cash reserve for a rainy day, which we may well be embarking on.
Okay, well, thank you. That, of course, is precisely the issue that the committee is currently considering, whether in fact the tax rates have been set at an optimum rate. Thank you.
That's probably a good time to bring in Ivan McKee, actually.
Time. Yeah, I mean, just a couple of observations on that, and I thank you for coming along and giving the evidence and reflecting on the points that Murdo made. Certainly, the analysis that we've done in the line of questioning we've had supports the data you've given us in terms of the number of transactions in that middle band, if you like, although it is really the top end. It's the top 6 or 7% of all transactions, but that 325, 750 does hold up. Very well. I mean, there was some evidence that if you hadn't done this, it might have increased more significantly, but that's very much a counterfactual, which there's no real evidence for, certainly in terms of the evidence it's got, the hypothesis that has damaged activity in that part of the market absolutely is not supported by the data we've seen. And just reflecting on the comments you made about the regional impact, we thankfully got some data in the last week or so, and when you analyse that, it shows if you go back 2 or 3 years, Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire was sitting at about 13.5% of Scottish transactions, and that has dropped to about 8.5% in the most recent data. So that shows a significant reduction relative to the rest of the country in terms of activity in that part of the market, which maybe answers some of the concerns that Alec Johnson maybe had earlier. My question really is, we're still in early days, as you indicated, we're a year and a half into this. At what point do you think we'd be in a position to be able to say we've seen enough data now to be able to say we fully understand the impact of this and we can move on to consider any future changes around about these bans and rates potentially going forward?
If I can connect Mr. McKee's point to Murdo Fraser's point, just say that we're all economists now. At what point will we have enough data to be able to understand the past, present, future? Well, it's easier to understand the past, understand what's going on in the present, but always difficult to predict the future. And even the latest information I've had this morning on the wider economy, for example, the Resolution Foundation's report into the choices that the Chancellor will have in terms of the Brexit decision, tells us it is very hard to forecast the future, but we'll do our best. It'll produce a range, and we will adapt the policy and the tax position on a year-by-year basis, as we would do through the budget process, engaging, listening, consulting as best we can. And also, and same goes for income tax, but taking the right decisions, but not to encourage bad cultural behaviours and tax avoidance and so on, and continue to apply the four maxims of Adam Smith and how we deliver Scottish tax policy. Does that assist?
James wanted to cover areas of the future, and you mentioned the future budget and yourself, so James.
Sure. Thanks, convener. You said in your opening statement that in terms of the 17-18 budget, you would announce, you know, new rates and bands, and obviously I don't expect you to comment on that this morning. But in terms of the outturn information that we have currently in relation to 15-16, is, again, as you said, it was forecast at 381 and it came in at 425 million. 44 million more. In relation to your desired out...
Sorry. It's 44 million higher.
Sorry, did I say lower? Yeah. Sorry, I apologise. 44 million higher. In relation to the 17-18 budget, what are your kind of objectives in terms of outturns? Is it within that range?
It would be within the range. Obviously, the SFC will produce their forecasts as well. So I think, again, there will be issues around turbulence in the economy, and we don't know what it will mean for house values, but we would want to sustain the income. And if there is an impact in the next financial year, then we will have the Scottish cash reserve to draw down from if we don't meet the forecasts and the planned income as part of that budget. And of course, we will revise the figures, and SFC will revise the figures, and that will be part of the publication of the budget process and the methodology.
Okay, thank you.
Willie, you've got a supplementary in this area, have you?
No, it was more really a follow-up supplementary to Murdo Fraser's question on the impact in different
areas. I'll let you, because it's still in residential area, then I'm going to come to Ash Denham. Move on to non-residential area, because we've not touched on that yet. So, yes, on you go.
Okay, thanks. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. In your opening remarks, you reminded us of some of the impacts that the LBTT tax has had. I think you said that 90% of people actually pay less or nothing at all now as a result of the measure that you've introduced. So is the impacts that you were expecting pretty much as expected when you were doing your forecasting for this tax, notwithstanding the difficult nature of making any forecasts at all, but really is it performing pretty much as you expected? And secondly, some people who gave evidence previously indicated to us about the pressures in the North East area, but they also indicated some pressures in the Edinburgh area and the high value market. So what I'd like to ask is that how do we square that with the data that we have in front of us that shows that the highest value range over £750,000, that's actually performing much better than the range just previously referred to that by Murdo Fraser? So it's a difficulty in understanding how the highest value properties in Scotland can be performing much better than a range beneath that.
There will always be differential impacts in different parts of the country because of the economy and more localised issues. But the headline for LBTT, I think it's been delivered effectively, responsibly. We've inherited the powers, and through, I think, a good sound policy approach and very efficient management. And you've heard from Revenue Scotland, I think everyone appreciates that they've got a very slick operation and a very efficient operation. And I remember the debates around this tax policy and how it should be implemented and who should operate it. And there was modelling done around how best to do it. I think the creation of Revenue Scotland has been vindicated. And there was a suggestion that maybe HMRC or someone else could do it, and this was the most efficient way to do it, and that's turned out to be true. In terms of the overall headline for Scotland, I mean, I have highlighted that it's had higher than expected revenue performance in its first year, as well as the policy benefits. The exact figure is 93% of house buyers paying less tax than under SDLT. and that includes those who pay no tax at all under LBTT, so I'm sure that that's welcome. And then, as I say, I've heard and I've listened very carefully to some of the commentary and the anecdotes around the upper end of the market, and I've explained the evidence suggests there's not the issue that's been suggested. I've also seen alternative suggestions, and I think it's maybe helpful to make committee aware of this. The Scottish Property Federation Homes for Scotland suggested changing the bans and changing the thresholds. I think it's reasonable that people put forward alternative suggestions as to how they think things could work differently. Now, a very preliminary modelling of what that would mean, their specific suggestions about raising thresholds, tells me, and to say it's preliminary, it can't truly judge behaviours, but figures, if it was to go to their model, would lead to, for the Scottish Property Federation modelling, an estimated loss of £32 million, and for the Homes for Scotland modelling, an estimated loss of £44 million. Now, unless you take that elsewhere in the tax system, then that means cut somewhere else. So that's why I think that our balance is the right one. But I have looked at the suggestions from elsewhere to say, if we're to model that, what would it mean? And that's the kind of loss that it would mean. And I'm happy to engage with these stakeholders at the round table that I've described. So hopefully that covers the benefits and looking at the alternate models. Because I think the government would be wrong just to rule out other people's suggested changes. But when we study them, we see that it carries significant risk and a potential loss of income entering what may well be a more difficult economic period.
Just a brief follow-up, Cabinet Secretary, thanks very much for that. You've said yourself, and we think there's pretty clear reasons why it's having such an impact at the high end of the market in the Aberdeen area. But what do you think might be causing that impact in the Edinburgh area, if the evidence we were given previously is to be believed that there's a stagnation perhaps in that higher end of the market in the Edinburgh area?
I'm sure the Economy Secretary, Keith Brown, could go into far more detail of what he thinks about the specific local economies, but both Aberdeen, Aberdeenshire and Edinburgh have for some time been quite buoyant in terms of growth, in terms of oil and gas. Obviously that's impacted in the North East. We're doing everything we can to support the economy there, taking a range of actions, but that's inevitable from the economic consequences of that. Edinburgh has sustained high and increasing house prices for some time, and maybe that was unsustainable.
Thank you.
Now, we've done a lot on the residential taxation issues, but we haven't really touched on, for the record purposes, in particular non-residential stuff, so I'm glad that Ash Denham's got a question in that area.
Thank you, Convener. So obviously, in the non-residential side, we've seen higher than expected revenues, and also there was a driver for the policy decision to set the rates slightly lower than the rest of the UK. To make Scotland a more attractive location for business. So I'm wondering, in any of the data you've seen, do you think there's any evidence of businesses choosing to locate here?
It's hard to say whether that specific tax policy has been the critical factor in a company locating in Scotland. But generally, our decisions on non-residential LBTT have been well received, and again the pattern shows a satisfactory number of transactions. And when it came to income, Ash Denham's correct to say that the outturn was much higher than the forecast by some £71 million. So the forecast was 146, outturn was 217, and that assisted with the overall positive variance.
So obviously this tax base is quite volatile, and a small number of really high value transactions, such as, for instance, maybe a shopping centre, makes it really difficult, in particular, to forecast precisely for this tax. So it was mentioned in the paper that there's a development on the forecasting and also on the methodology for future forecasting. Could you comment on that a bit further?
Just in terms of the methodology, I think we caveat it to say that there are issues, as you've described, around the predictability and how month to month or quarter to quarter it's very difficult to assess. So if you take an annual view, it gives you a better picture of what's happening. But you're right, it's not like house transactions that may be more consistent. When it comes to these high value property transactions, they're pretty significant, and sometimes very specific reasons why it's being sold, and that's beyond just the tax levers.
I suppose what I'm asking is, would you expect, as the tax kind of beds in, for the outturn and the forecast to be closer together?
Not necessarily, because of the point that I've just made, that it will continue to be volatile just because of the nature of commercial transactions. It's not often planned. There are many influencers on why property changes hands. So it's fair to say it will probably continue to be volatile. But of course, I'd want the outturn to be as close to forecast as possible, unless it's a positive outturn much higher than forecast. But hopefully our forecasting is accurate and sustainable. And of course, the Scottish Fiscal Commission will oversee.
Thank you. One of the challenges the committee has been facing, certainly a challenge I've faced over the recent weeks, is the publication of the data on housing market in Scotland, and that relates to both the figures produced by Revenue Scotland and Register Scotland, who publish different sets of data at different times, and then it's retrospectively updated and corrected, meaning at times, certainly I've been at cross purposes with the witnesses in terms of the data that's been in front of us. And I just wondered if there's any way that the government could reflect on that to make in future the analysis much easier for not just this committee, but you know, stakeholders from outside, when they're looking at what Register Scotland have and Revenue Scotland produce, to make that analysis easier for people in terms of how the information is produced. I just, is it something you might want to take on that would help everybody, I think, in that regard?
If you allow me, convener, to reflect on that point, and I'll see what I can do about better alignment of data and statistics. I wouldn't want to set any hairs running, though, to say that, you know, for the publication of month-to-month statistics, folks say, oh, you're not meeting your forecast every month, or you are, you're getting too much, whatever, because as we've described, month-to-month doesn't tell you the full picture. Quarterly is better, annual is reality. But if you will allow me to reflect on that point, Communion, some of these releases of data is out with our direct control, but let's see if we can try and harmonise some of it.
I also recognise that the Register Scotland and Revenue Scotland have different needs in their own right in terms of the information they produce, but I think it would help for transparency if we could do something around that. Thank you, Kavir. Can I thank both the witnesses very much for coming along and giving us evidence on this session this morning. We now move to the next item. And the third item on today's agenda is to consider a Scottish statutory instrument relating to appointments to the Scottish Fiscal Commission. Before we come to the motion seeking our approval at agenda item 4, we have an evidence session on the order. We're joined for this session by the same witnesses who just gave us evidence on LBTT. So without further ado, I could invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a opening statement in this regard.
Thank you, Convener. You see, the day job keeps me quite busy. The purpose of this order is to enable Scottish ministers to bring appointments to the Scottish Fiscal Commission, which does not yet exist in law, within the remit of the Commissioner for Ethical Standards and Public Life in Scotland, and therefore enable the Commissioner to regulate the appointments. The role of the Commissioner will help ensure that the appointments process is fair and open, and that the successful applicants are appointed on merit. Thank
you. Any questions from any of the committee in this regard? Okay, I therefore invite the Cabinet Secretary. So I'm trying to now move to item agenda 4, which is consideration motion on the order. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S5M01595 that the Finance and Constitution Committee recommends that the Public Appointments and Public Bodies, etc. Scotland Act 2003, treatment of Scottish Fiscal Commission as specified authority, Order 2016, be approved.
I move.
Do any members have any questions at this stage? Okay, and I put the question. The question is that motion S5M01595 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're agreed. The committee will now publish a short report to the Parliament setting out a decision on this order. I suspend this particular part of the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. We're now back in session. The next item on our agenda is to consider the Scottish Statutory Instrument, which provides for the 2016-17 Autumn Budget Revision. Before we come to the motion seeking approval, at agenda item 6, we'll have an evidence session on the order. We are joined for this session by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Constitution, Dermot Mackay, and supporting officials Scott Mackay and Ian Storey of the Scottish Government. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. The Autumn Budget Revision provides the first of two opportunities to firmly amend the Scottish Budget for 2016-17. In order to assist the Committee with their scrutiny, I've provided a brief guide to the Autumn Budget Revision prepared by my officials. That guide sets out the background to and details of the main changes proposed, and I hope that Committee members have found this guide helpful. Table 1.8 and page 9 of the supporting document shows the approved budgets in the Budget Bill as realigned to reflect new portfolio structure announced by the First Minister on the 18th of May 2016. This year's Autumn Budget Revision deals with four different types of amendments to the budget. Firstly, a few funding changes. Secondly, a couple of technical adjustments that will have no impact on spending power. Thirdly, a Whitehall transfer. And finally, some budget-neutral transfers of resources between portfolio budgets. The net impact of all of these changes is an increase in the approved budget of £259.4 million. Table 1.1 and page 4 of the supporting document shows the approved budgets following the changes sought in the Autumn Budget Revision. The first set of changes comprise mainly of deployments of available resources sourced from the Barnett Consequentials, Budget Exchange and tax receipts to various portfolios to meet ministerial priorities and manage outstanding pressures. In total, these changes increase the budget by £151.8 million. The second set of changes comprise a couple of technical adjustments to the budget. The technical adjustments are non-cash and therefore budget neutral, as they cannot be redeployed to support discretionary spend elsewhere and have a net positive impact of £107 million on the total overall aggregate position. It is necessary to reflect these adjustments to ensure the budget is consistent with the accounting requirements and with the final outturn that will be reported in our annual accounts. The Scottish budget aligns with the accounting requirements under the Government Financial Reporting Manual. Accordingly, budget provision is included within the Scottish budget for the financial year to reflect the recognition of relevant transport assets within revenue finance infrastructure schemes in accordance with accounting requirements. The adjustment to budget at this Autumn Budget Revision is £157 million. The other technical adjustment is to reduce the student loans RAB charge by £50 million in line with forecast requirements following a change to the UK discount rate. With regard to Whitehall transfers and allocations from HM Treasury, there's a net positive impact on the budget of £0.6 million in relation to the proceeds of the tampon tax, which is used to fund women's charities. The final part of the budget revision concerns the transfer of funds within and between portfolios to better align the budgets with profiled spend. In line with past years, there are a number of internal portfolio transfers which have no effect on portfolio totals, but ensure that internal budget lines are monitored and managed effectively. The main transfers between portfolios are noted in the SBR supporting document and the guide to the SBR. Sorry, that should be ABR, not SBR. As we move towards the financial year end, we will continue in line with our normal practice to monitor forecast outturn against budget. Furthermore, wherever possible, we will seek to utilise any emerging underspends to ensure that we make optimal use of the resources available in 2016-17 and to proactively manage the flexibility provided under the budget exchange mechanism agreed between HM Treasury and the devolved administrations. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Yeah, the stuff was helpful, but it does beg some questions, Convener, the material that was provided by the Government. I've certainly got a couple myself. I know other members want to come in. My particular question, first question relates to Annex B, which is the inter-portfolio transfers of over £5 million. And particularly the transfer to education and skills portfolio for nursing and midwifery education from the health and wellbeing and sport portfolio of £54 million. Now, my understanding is from, and this is just from discussions, that this has been something that's happened for a considerable amount of time, but for the life of me, I don't understand why. So if you could explain that to me and persuade me it's the right thing we're doing in terms of how we're accounting for that spend and why it's being transferred in that way, that would be very helpful.
Okay, Convener, I appreciate the point. I suppose it's really as simple as this, that there's relevant spend that's controlled by one minister or portfolio, and this it can be in relation to health. They have the budget because they're making the policy decision, but it's actually spent elsewhere. So how health and education relate to each other. So the decision maker is there, but the actual spend is elsewhere, and that's the reason for the cross-portfolio transfer. That's my words. If you want an official interpretation of that, I can supplement my answer with that. Scott?
Well, Mr McKay is absolutely right. The policy decisions and the outcome of those policy decisions are felt in the budget within the health portfolio, and the actual delivery is funded through the funding council, but they don't take the policy decisions. So it's right that at the start of the year, the budget is reflected in the area where the responsibility for the policy lies.
I put this in my terms, if that's okay. Does this really mean, in effect, that the health and wellbeing and sport and see a need for greater level of skills for nursing and midwifery, and effectively they're the commissioning agent from the Education and Lifelong Learning organisation to make this happen? Is that the simple
correct
way to put it?
Yes.
Okay, that's fine. I now understand it.
Thanks for helping us out, convener.
That's okay. on block grant adjustment issues, I wonder if you could update the committee on the block grant adjustment devolved taxes for 2016-17. They don't appear to be included in the autumn budget revision. Can you tell us when that final figure will be agreed for 2016-17? For instance, will it come in the spring budget review, which is obviously, I think it's due in February, is it?
From 15-16 going into 2016.
The block grant, sorry, can we just clarify, the block grant adjustment in respect of
devolved taxes for 2016-17?
Yeah. We've agreed a block grant adjustment for the year,
right,
as set out in the draft budget document. That will not be revisited. The block grant adjustment will not be revisited until the outturn data is available for the Scottish taxes, which will be after the year end. So there is a correction mechanism embedded within the fiscal framework, but once we've agreed at the start of the year the block grant adjustment, that's not revisited then until that outturn.
There's no in-year adjustment in that case.
So there's not an adjustment in-year to the block grant adjustment. There may be revisions to the forecast as part of the the work through the year as data becomes available.
Okay, I think we might come back to you on that. Not in terms of this exercise today, but I think I'd certainly need a bit more clarity on what that means. James, and I'll come to Murdoch.
Just in terms of funding changes, which you noted were 151.8 million, and it's split over the budget exchange mechanism, Barnett consequentials, and tax receipts. Can you detail how that's broken down?
Some of this information would have been released before in terms of budget exchange income. I reported this to the Chamber, so I can happily re-provide all that information. So what we covered before, which we've touched upon earlier, this was higher than forecast income through devolved taxes, as we've described through LBTT and landfill tax. In terms of carry forward, the 0.4% of the total budget that was carried for, available for spend, anything else through Barnett consequentials, I can give you further information on if you'd like in writing. As you'll recall, in terms of the above forecast income from devolved taxes, I think that figure was 74 million, which we put into the Scottish Cash Reserve. So if you want a further breakdown, I can certainly provide that, but it is as I outlined to the Chamber previously.
Right, if you could break down how the 151.8 million breaks over those three areas, that would be helpful. I appreciate you don't have the information right at this minute. Just in terms then of the tax receipts, you know, you mentioned LBTT and you spoke earlier about how that money was transferred into a cash reserve. and not used in terms of like day-to-day funding. How does that work? It looks, interpreting this note, it looks as if the tax receipts as part of this, 151 million, have been used as part of, you know, the revision for day-to-day funding, whereas previously you spoke about it being held in a cash reserve separately.
No, it will rest in the cash reserve and can be drawn down in the next financial year if the revenues from those same devolved taxes aren't what we require them to be, so it remains in the cash reserve.
So as part of this 151 million, there are tax receipts, and are you saying that they've gone to the cash reserve?
Well, I'll clarify the exact line because there's a separate issue around the additional dwelling supplement, but what I've said would happen with the cash reserve is exactly what's happened, but Scott Mackay can pick up your specific point.
In terms of supporting the additional funding, there were some tax receipts forecast for additional dwelling supplement that weren't applied at budget bill stage, so that's part of what's been brought in to support the additional funding allocation. It's allocations that have been made in the autumn budget revision. Not the surplus tax receipts from last year, which, as Mr. Mackay indicated, have gone into the reserve.
Sorry, I'm maybe not getting this right. You've got a table of 151 million of funding changes, and you know that's detailed over a number of lines, right? As part of your explanation for the funding changes, you're saying that that includes tax receipts. So where are the tax receipts? Are they in this table or are they in the cash reserve?
Well, there's two different elements to the tax receipts. There's the surplus tax receipts over and above what was originally forecast in 15-16, which have been put in the cash reserve. In terms of sources of funds that have been applied to the 151 million, there were some forecast tax receipts in respect of the additional dwelling supplement, which were set out in the draft budget, but were not applied as we moved through the budget bill, and that's part of what has supported the additional funding. So that's part of the overall forecast receipts for 2015-16, rather than the surplus tax receipts from the...
If these were set out in the draft budget, how come they're being produced as an addition at this time? Are you saying they were included in a note to the draft budget, but they weren't?
They weren't applied as part of the funding. The legislation hadn't passed at that point, so they were there was an indication that was obviously going to come forward, and there was an estimate of the additional revenues that were expected to be generated, but reflecting the fact that the legislation hadn't come forward to introduce that, they weren't applied at that point.
So that wasn't included in the draft budget overall total at that time?
Uh-huh. Yeah. ADS came after the budget. ADS came after the budget bill, hence the revision now.
Right, okay. It may be helpful just when you provide clarification in terms of the breakdown, the funding changes in relation to the tax receipts, you also provide just an explanation of that, even just for my benefit.
No, I think it's a helpful point. I think we all recognise now that tax and spend is far more complex, and some of it has changed over the year. So that there's the information that's already been explained to Parliament, but how it all interrelates is a very fair point. So we'll have a summary of all of that together, if that's of assistance.
Murdo and then Ivan.
Thank you, Convener. I'm trying to understand what's been happening with the Strategic Forum. I remember from my days convening the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee, we took quite a bit of interest in this body, which, if I recall, was set up to try and deliver efficiency savings across a range of public sector bodies. Now, according to Annex A, the Strategic Forum appears to have had an increase in spending of 11.7 million. Now, there's also been, according to Annex B, a transfer within portfolios of 5.4 million from culture, tourism and external affairs to economy, jobs and fair work. I'm not quite sure I understand what's going on here. Can you explain it, perhaps, Cabinet Secretary?
Well, it's right to say there's the Strategic Forum savings where all public sector organisations are expected to be more efficient and certainly to cooperate and to collaborate on that to achieve savings. And that's certainly been going on. But in terms of the exact budget line transfers, I'll ask Scott Mackay to come in with the detail.
So the transfer from culture represents the contribution from Visit Scotland to the Strategic Forum savings. There was an inbuilt target in setting the budget to embed the challenge, the efficiency challenge, and the contribution flows from each of the individual organisations over the course of the year in order to support the generality of funding across different portfolio.
If I follow up, Convener, how does that relate then to what looks like an additional spend of £11.7 million?
The additional spend of 11.7?
Yeah, Annex A shows Strategic Forum additional spend of 11.7 million.
If you want, we can go back to you in writing, Mr. Fraser, and give you the detail on this. If you want to follow up, then that would be fine.
Perhaps, Cabinet Secretary, if you stuck to the day job, we'd have more time to look at these issues.
Well, if you want to ask questions, that's absolutely fine. If you want the detail, then we can give you that line by line.
Thank you.
I had a small question on the numbers in the budget bill, and then maybe explore something else as well. It's on the baby box, and just for my clarification, so these are the numbers for 16-17. But the baby box obviously starts a pilot in the new year, but it's only going out to 1 or 2% of the country, and then it'll be the summer before there's a full rollout, as I understand it. So why would that spend be in this year? Should it not be in next year?
I think we've described how we'll be rolling out the baby box from pilot to implementation, so obviously that means some spend in current year, then further spend in future years.
Yeah, but obviously it wouldn't be 6 million, it'd be a smaller number, I would imagine. It would be.
It doesn't fit the forecasting. Yeah, it is, yeah. It's simply based on the forecasting.
Right, so. Okay. So if it doesn't happen, then clearly that just rolls into the next year. Yeah.
Yes, but I think we've begun to outline how we will implement the policy.
Aye. Mm-hmm. Okay. 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 The other thing I was going to ask about, and I don't know if this is the right place to ask, it was around about the details about the performance framework.
It's probably not involved in this particular discussion, Ivan. I'm sorry.
Okay, no problem.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, we now, in that case, move to agenda item 6, which is consideration of the motion on the order. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S5M01839 that the Finance and Constitution Committee recommends that the Budget Scotland Act 2016 Amendment Regulations 2016 be approved.
I move, Convener.
Thank you. Do members have any further comments? There be no further comments. I now put the question in motion. The question is that motion S5M01839 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The committee will now publish a short report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the order. I thank you. For attending, Cabinet Secretary, together with your witnesses. As agreed at the start of the meeting, we'll take the next item of business in private. And at its next meeting, the committee will take evidence on the public finances and economic performance as we start our pre-budget scrutiny. I now close the public part of this meeting. Thank you.